to the future of medicine, because it can be seen by a billion people at no extra cost. That's the beauty of the internet.
Welcome to the International Functional Forum, live from London. Thanks for joining us in the charge to accelerate the evolution of medicine. Please welcome your host, Dr. Rangan Chatterjee.
Thank you. Good evening to everyone who's watching this online. We've got people all over the globe watching the very first International Functional Forum here, live from the Royal Society of Medicine in London. It's an absolute delight to be here, and I think for many of us here in the UK and this side of the Atlantic, I think there's been a feeling that actually this movement is growing in momentum in the US. But what about the rest of the world? How relevant is what's going on in the US to us here in the UK and in Europe and in other countries? And so I think it's very important that we start to have our own forum, and I'm delighted that James and his team have decided to allow us to have our forum here four times a year. This is the very first one. The next one is in April. We've got a live audience here in London. We sold out very quickly, and so for the next one in April, we're going to try and get a bigger venue. A big feature of the evolution of medicine is to encourage communities, health communities, but also communities where healthcare providers can watch these forums with each other as a mechanism to grow their local communities, but also have a discussion afterwards. And there's many people around the world who are currently watching this. We know we've got meetup groups in Europe. We know we've got meetup groups in the UK. And we know we've got some meetup groups in Africa who can watch it on this time zone. We've not been able to watch them live before because in America it's the middle of the night over here. So welcome to everyone who's watching on their meetups. The next Function Forum is on April the 4th, and that is going to be in London. Most of them will be in London, although we are talking about taking it around Europe to various locations as demand grows. I think demand is going to grow because there's something happening with lifestyle medicine. There's something happening with functional medicine. Before, it was seen to be on the fringes of medical care, but that is changing. I'm getting emails from medical students every week. They're asking, how do we learn about this? I'm actually seeing someone who was a student in Edinburgh who I had the pleasure of lecturing at Edinburgh University Medical School in November. They invited me to come and speak to them about functional medicine, about lifestyle medicine, and whether this should be in the curriculum. That is a very old school, very prestigious, but very old-fashioned medical school. And so for them to embrace even the possibility that this is going to go into the medical curriculums, I think, is a huge leap forward. I very much hope that other medical schools will follow suit, and I have been contacted since then. I think it's like many of these things. Once one person jumps, other people start to follow. And so I really think there is a necessity for a movement here. We are going to be having questions at a panel discussion, a live panel discussion at the end today. And you can ask questions. The studio can ask them, not the studio, the Royal Society of Medicine can ask questions here, but you can use the hashtag Functional Forum on Twitter to ask questions. I'll be checking it throughout the evening, and I'll be putting your questions to the panel later on. Our very first speaker this evening is somebody who works in the National Health Service. And actually, the NHS is something that actually underpins our whole healthcare system in the United Kingdom. And so I think that's why a lot of the time, many of us who go over to the States to learn principles, or we watch some of these courses online, we struggle with, well, how do we convert that into a publicly funded healthcare system? And the theme tonight very much is the National Health Service. Our first speaker actually is a consultant psychiatrist within the National Health Service. I think psychiatry is a field that lends itself very nicely to this model of care, particularly because the pharmaceutical model, I think, has very much reached its ceiling and very much has a limited approach. Mental health is rising. We cannot cope, and we need to think of other models of care. So without further ado, consultant psychiatrist Dr. Pratima Singh.
Right. Thank you, Rangan. Thank you, James, for this opportunity. So unlike James' usual guests, who are experts in functional medicine, I'm not. I am a bystander. I'm an observer of conventional mental health service who has increasingly felt quite uneasy about the superficial way in which medicine is practiced in mental health settings in the UK. And it's a costly affair. In England, poor mental health is estimated to drive up the annual cost of treating long-term chronic physical health conditions by up to £13 billion. Some estimates say that the disability related to mental illness cost us as our economy as much as it takes to run the whole of NHS. Deficits are rising, progressively rising, with more and more trust going into the red. And this is particularly pertinent for mental health trusts who have suffered from historical disinvestment and marginalization. In terms of the patients, the years lived with disability due to mental health conditions is in excess compared to any other disease category. And interestingly, these numbers have not changed over the last two decades. So what are we doing wrong? So mental health services in United Kingdom are extremely complex, and they are in constant flux. And one of the ways that mental health services have responded to external economic pressures is by undergoing series of transformation. These transformations are aptly described by the Skings Fund, which is a think tank in the UK, as a leap in the dark. And what it has led to is serious decline in patient care because cost reduction has been the focus. Now, what looks like a rather busy diagram, it actually an oversimplified version of how a mental health trust. So what you see in green are various GP services of various size from a region transferring patients, referring patients onto the mental health services in blue. And in order to cope with demand, what mental health services are doing internally are creating something akin to an acute care model. So you would have teams, such as the assessment liaison teams, which is the kind of team that I work in, which has been entrusted the impossible task of referring back and dealing with patients within a very short period of time, and mandated to send back about 80% of patients referred, and then allow transition into longer-term teams based on their needs. Now, this creates bottlenecks throughout the system. This repeated transformation before having any opportunity to evaluate has been a trouble, and soon every part of the system begins to get saturated. Internally, the teams respond to this by creating waiting lists, working in silos, or simply, you know, burning out. It also leads to artificial focus. So, you know, you look at the health system and decide, okay, inpatient beds, that's the costliest bit. Let's focus on that. So beds have been seriously cut down in numbers. And there are teams created, you know, on paper, which are supposed to think about looking at better places to treat people with mental illness, but end up becoming no more than gatekeepers, which have the job of making sure that less and less number of people go into an expensive part of the pathway. The National Confidential Inquiry in Suicides and Homicides by People with Mental Illness is a very important document, and they recently had their 20-year review. And what they showed, that the increased focus on reducing hospital admissions has shown that, yes, suicides are declining over time, but there are three times more suicides happening in home treatment team. And some of these are happening within the first 3 days that the patient is with them. So it makes you wonder whether we have really resolved any problem or have we just shifted it into another part. The other underappreciated and unseen impact of this is staff burnout. Really hardworking, skilled staff are burning out due to more and more being demanded of them with less and less resources and being forced to apply themselves to an acute care model that just does not work for chronic mental health conditions. I think the other aspect of this is over-reliance on medication. So, I mean, just to give you an example, 100% of patients that I see in an initial assessment and treatment team already arrive from GP services with prescribed medications, and sometimes they have been on several trials of these of medications. And then the job for us is to not only review their treatment, but rationalize medication. And some people would say that this is a good sign that more people are receiving treatment. However, for me, it's a horrifying thought that we are using rather risky psychiatric medication as our first approach without looking at other factors. I'm finding myself reporting more and more quite serious, sometimes life-threatening, if not fatal, side effects of medications to agencies such as the Yellow Card Reporting, which is run by the Medicines and Health Products Regulating Agency. And I think what we also do not yet know is what is the long-term impact of using the medication in this manner? What is it affecting? I mean, we know it causes metabolic problems, but what is it doing to some of the crucial metabolic pathways in the body, and how does it affect the whole system? The other aspect, unfortunately, which I think is one of my gravest concern, is that it forces us as clinicians to look at patients in parts. So, for example, in Rangan and Sarah's usual day, they would, you know, of the odd 40 patients that they would see in a day in NHS, 16 patients will present with a mental health problem, who will probably be sent to a mental health service. They would also have metabolic problems, endocrine problems, nutritional deficiency, which will not be looked at in the mental health service. And we will work on a belief that it is possible for a completely separate part of the system that is going to take care of it on its own without mental health services getting involved in it. And I don't feel that works. So is it time for a change? Is it time for us to ask, you know, whether whatever it is that creates health for a gastrointestinal system, for cardiovascular system, are the same things that possibly create health, which leads to good mental health? And unless we integrate these approaches in our practice, I think care is going to be fragmented, and we are going to perpetuate this belief for our patients that the locus of health is outside of them and located in the different specialties rather than within themselves. And I think it also dismisses the role of primary interventions that need to happen first before the specialist approaches. I think it is a social imperative now to utilize the latest science about inflammation, the gut microbiome, and oxidative injury due to inactivity or stress or possibly diet and even medication and its impact on mental health. Because if we don't do, what is the impact? I think it will seriously impact in whatever we are doing now. So, for example, this is an interesting meta-analysis that asked the question about, so what happens to people if they have raised stress markers at the start of therapy, and they correlate that with poorer outcomes at the end. So it might negate the things that you are trying to do, and we see this in our practice on a daily basis. I think it also reminds us that depression has had an evolutionary role. There are common substrates with inflammations, and that approaches need to possibly address this for greatest benefit. And sometimes it can tell us what we might have completely missed so far. So this is a very interesting study that is already leading to change in clinical practice on many psychiatric wards. And this study showed that a group of patients presenting for the first time with psychosis actually have antibodies against their own neuronal cell surfaces. And their presentation is undistinguishable from any other psychosis. So unless you test it, you do not know, and medication given to this group might not make that much of a difference. So what hope do I see? Where do I see the role of functional medicine in the UK? I feel that there are structures in mental health services in UK that already provide an interesting framework that can be adapted to the functional medicine model. So for example, in mental health services, there is already a tradition of having that in-depth consultations where we chart a timeline, sometimes starting from preconception to the time that the patient presents for advice. And along with that, we draw parallels of all the significant things that have happened along the way. Life events, social factors, as well as health events. However, we limit ourselves to using all this rich information for formulation. And I feel there is so much more we could be doing with that. The other advantage is about how mental health teams work. We are used to working with people with multiple skills. So I envisage that in future, a mental health team would not only have nurses and social workers and psychologists, but possibly nutritionists and possibly a well-being coach to work with patients, or even a movement instructor, who knows. There are also some other useful structures that exist that can be utilized. So for example, the trust that I work in has something called as a recovery college. And I think it's interesting to note that this was a user-led program. So patients, it was a patient's idea. And I think this already has a group education-based model where patients can enroll for free in 6 to 8 up to 12 week long courses based on anything that they see relevant to their well-being. So there are already courses running in the trust that I work in on, you know, good sleep or medication management or stress reduction, mindfulness meditation, and I think this can easily be built on. And for things that are not there, there are key relationships. And so one of the charities that I signpost people to is Food for the Brain charity in the UK. And they have the Brain Bioclinic, which is a specialist mental health clinic that patients who do take this on can refer themselves. It is something that more and more patients of mine have been showing an interest, and I make it a point to have these conversations. And I also want to make a special point about existing mental health charities such as Mind, Young Lewisham, SAME, with whom we closely work, and to be honest, we possibly would not survive without, because I think they have interesting programs for volunteering, peer support, that give our patients the community that they need in order to take this forward. So to end, I would like to remind us of the fable of the elephant and the 6 blind men. And, you know, just to be aware that we might all be, you know, feeling a different part of the beast. And I think with humility, we need to accept that, you know, whatever we know of the beast now might only be a small part of the problem. And unless we have an open mind and we have a respectful stance about what others are seeing and others are bringing it, we will probably miss the big picture. Thank you. Could not survive the life. Because I think they have interesting programs for volunteering, peer support, that give our patients the community that they need in order to take this forward. So to end, I would like to remind us of the fable of the elephant and the 6 blind men. And, you know, just to be...
That was a very key phrase from Dr. Singh's talk being repeated there. Thank you, Dr. Singh. I thought it was excellent. Very eye-opening, particularly what you said at the end about keeping an open mind and actually being respectful. Yeah, really good and very much needed, I think, as this field grows and we try and integrate various different healthcare professionals together. Your slide on cortisol, I thought was excellent and really made me think how, you know, we know in medicine as doctors that stress plays a role in many different diseases, in the pathogenesis, but also in propagating it further. But I think we are missing a more detailed understanding of the pathways that are involved. And I find measuring cortisol actually super useful. It's something I never used to do in NHS general practice. but I've evolved it into my practice a lot. But in terms of being respectful, when the British Medical Journal reviewed the BBC One show, Doctor in the House, that was on at the end of 2015, the reviewer, who is a GP, was very scathing about my use of salivary cortisol tests. And I feel that comes from really not keeping an open mind. I feel that was quite derogatory and quite frustrating, because that really was a critical test in actually changing the patient's behavior and the patient's behavior patterns because of what they could see. We do need respect, we do need humility, we do need to acknowledge. Salivary cortisol tests are used every day in Manchester University labs by the neuroscientists to get a snapshot of what's going on. It's good enough for them, it's good enough for clinical practice, in my view. Psychiatry, the evolution of psychiatry, is the next functional forum. Now, just to be clear, there is the US functional forum that is continuing on the first Monday of every month, which you can watch live, 7 p.m., I think, Eastern Time, 8 p.m. Eastern Time in the United States. There is also, as well as that, so this is the US forum. As well as that, there are going to be four international forums. This is the first one, four per year. The next one is in April. I think there's been a bit of confusion about, you know, where these things are. That's, if it's not clear, let me know on Twitter using the hashtag Functional Forum. Here we go. Also, there's going to be a Q&A panel this evening with our speakers, but also with Dr. Ayan Panja. So please do stick around for that and ask me any questions regarding that using the hashtag Functional Forum. Now, since I got into the field of functional medicine and lifestyle medicine, one of the big obstacles I faced was, I love learning all the clinical wisdom, but then there's a big problem. How do you then apply that in the setting in which we work, which really has not been set up, certainly here in the UK, the system has not been set up to allow that model of care. And one thing that's all I've always liked about the Functional Forum is that they've always been very keen not only to bring you clinical wisdom, but also practical wisdom as to how you translate it into clinical practice. So our next speaker is actually the founder of the Functional Forum, who's going to talk a little bit about practice building models. So here he is, the creator of the Functional Forum, Mr. James Maskell. Can I kick you?
Can I kick you? Thank you. Can I kick you? I quite like having a hype man. I've never had a hype man before. I'm normally the hype man, so it's good. I get to choose all my own music, and I get to choose that I get to speak too, because I invented it. So anyway, I want to talk a little bit about practice transformation tools. This is not a full talk. This is really the sponsor segment. Most of the sponsors that we have on the American Forum are not really relevant to the UK market. So I wanted to start by just saying thank you so much for sharing what you did about peer support, because that was it was a great talk, and I really feel this used to be my favorite quote on community, which is, community is the guru of the future, from Thich Nhat Hanh. I definitely feel that's true when it comes to patient care. Look, the only untapped resource that we have access to that scales to infinity is peer-to-peer support. It's unlimited. You know, when you put two peers into connection with each other, it's valuable to both of them, and it costs no one anything. And so, you know, my new favorite quote when it comes to community is from Charles Eisenstein. And he says, a community is a group of people bounded together by gifts and stories. So think about this functional medicine community for a while. We all share a same story. We believe that functional medicine has a role to play in the future of medicine, and it's all about the gift. So I just want to say, you know, when Rangan's talking about starting a meetup, your gift might be coming to this event here. Your gift might be starting a meetup. Your gift might be just doing this in the field every day and helping people. But the more gifts that we can give to the community at large, we can build that community. And that's what we're talking about. So we're only just going to talk about two products that we've made. In the last year, we made a jump from essentially being just a publishing company, making content, to actually solving the big problem. So last year in May, the first big study of functional medicine doctors came out and gave us for the first time an understanding of what are the key things that are not happening in practice right now, or what is not working. And what we saw is that essentially we need to massively change the efficiency of the delivery of functional medicine if, one, functional medicine doctors are going to make as much money, if not more, than GPs,
and two, if it's going to become the standard of care. So we created this program called the Practice Accelerator. And the point of the Practice Accelerator is to learn from the best practices. We have a really interesting viewpoint at the evolution of medicine, seeing what's going on. So, you know, when we talk about practice efficiency, we're talking about group structures. How do you run a group visit? How do you run a group education event? We had a question on Twitter already, someone asking, you know, the biggest leverage is food, but no one knows how to cook. So I'm just going to tell you one story of a doctor. His name's Dr. Sachin Patel. He's in Canada, real innovator in the space. He was hearing from his patients that everyone was saying, well, it takes too long to cook. Now I used to go to McDonald's. Now, you know, you're telling me to cook home. I don't have time to cook lunch and dinner all these times. So he got 20 of those patients together. He rented a commercial kitchen with his nutritionist, got them in a room together, and each of them made a dish for 20 people. Right? So they made 20 meals for 20 people in 90 minutes with wine. Right? So everyone's having a great time, new social connections are created, and everyone leaves with 20 little Tupperwares of breakfast, lunch, and dinner for the rest of the week. And the power, to me, that smells like the future of medicine. That is empowered, people empowering each other, that's peer-to-peer support, that's community being created. So we're helping people to facilitate and operationalize these kind of things in their practice, in the Practice Accelerator. We also talk about marketing, but we talk it in the theme of community building. What's the difference between marketing and community building? In community building, you bring people in and you introduce them to each other, right? The best thing that you see that we can do is to introduce people who want to be healthy to someone else who wants to be healthy, because there can be accountability and support from each other. That's why things like Weight Watchers. Is Weight Watchers a really powerful clinical program? Yes or no? No. Right? Look at the ingredients in that thing. It's weird, right? But what they do have is they've really worked out the peer-to-peer community support part. So we can learn from these industries and see what's really working. And then the biggest thing is patient pre-education. The biggest efficiency drain to all of our practices is the fact that the majority of the delivery of education is delivered one-to-one in a clinical setting. If you're the main provider, you don't have time to do that. You need to outsource that to someone who's going to be billing at a lower rate and can spend the time with it. So you mentioned health coaches. I want to mention on next month's Functional Forum on February 6th, we're going to be seeing the practice of Dr. Scott Shannon. And he's delivering integrative psychiatry with psychiatrists, naturopathic doctors, biofeedback, and health coach. That's the team. And they all work together. They do their rounds together. They talk about the patients. And everyone's doing their very specific thing. The health coach is helping them implement the program. The biofeedback practitioners is doing exactly that. The naturopathic doctor is coming up with the lifestyle prescription. And the psychiatrist is just monitoring the whole thing. Look at Dean Ornish's program for intensive cardiac rehab. 72 hours available on insurance. And the doctor's only really doing 2 hours of it. It's a six-person team. So that's the efficiency that we're talking about. And patient pre-education is huge, and it's really easy to do it. So if you go to goevomed.com/accelerator, the accelerator is open. We've had over 400 doctors come into the program, and the goal is to create a hive mind of practitioners that are interested in running these really innovative practices. There is still, don't get me wrong, we don't have to wait for the NHS to evolve. Right now, there is still plenty of opportunity to build these kind of practices in the UK, and the accelerator helps you build a more scalable practice. The other program that we came up with is called the Membership Practice Builder. Now, who's heard of the Chinese medical model where you only paid when you were well and you didn't pay where you were sick? Does that intuitively feel like something that works for you and works for them? It sort of feels like the kind of thing that I think everyone likes. So one of the most innovative models that we're seeing in the US right now is this membership practice, which is basically an ongoing low monthly payment. In direct primary care, it can be as low as $60 a month, even lower for kids sometimes. But when you're doing functional medicine, it typically has to be a bit higher, because typically you're front loading a lot of value into the relationship. You're doing a lot of consultations early. So what we've done on the Membership Practice Builder, we worked with the absolute authority in the industry, and in that course, there is a training on exactly how to, as it says there, to help you position, launch, and launch a membership-based practice. And what you see is that if you can get paid consistently, one of the big things is that if your goal for retirement is to sell your practice, just know that if you have a fee-for-service practice, it's very difficult to convince the next person that you're about to sell your practice to that there's any value in the patient records. Whereas on the other hand, if you have 400 patients at $150 a month, and that's $60,000 a month coming into the practice, you know that's predictable income streams. When you sell a practice to another, what you're selling is predictable future income streams. And so what we're seeing is more and more doctors are doing this because it makes it affordable to more people, and it actually creates an asset that, you know, that you can sell to another provider when you transfer the care. So these are the two products that we've made. Obviously, we're building the community still with the Functional Forum, and you know, thanks for the opportunity to talk about it. Look, when I was speaking in South Africa, I said, what about this? What if we just had a moratorium? I know you've got the AFMCP coming up, Mike, and I know Dale Bredesen's coming over later, and it's a very exciting year clinically. But what if, as a practitioner community, we just decided that in 2017, we were going to take a clinical moratorium? We all know enough to get going and do this kind of medicine. What if we spent a whole year organizing? Organizing meetup communities, organizing safe places in every zip code where doctors could come and learn about functional medicine in a safe space with other providers. What if we saw doctors spending time not on learning the pathways that I know is fun to learn, and I know it's fun to geek out if you're that kind of provider, but at the same time, just know it's kind of not that useful, right? What's really useful is setting an example for the next generation of providers on how to actually run these kind of practices. So that's a challenge to the international community, is can we spend 2017 working out the practical nature of delivering and building participatory clinics? And that, I think, is the most important thing that we could do, because the model of acute care and chronic care are very, very different. One does not evolve into another. And so I would put that as a challenge to the community. So that's all I've got. Thanks so much for listening, and we'll move on. Rangan.
Thanks a lot, James. I absolutely agree. Community, I think, is critical. Just you guys being in here, that's our little community tonight. And hopefully that will lend itself to a great panel discussion later. And then also, you know, over drinks later, people getting together. This is not about doctors versus nutritionists versus other healthcare professionals. It's about getting together. It's about integrating, working out what we're all good at. We've all got a unique skill set and we can all work together. I know there has been a lot of frustration within various professions, or a feeling of, just a feeling of, you know, maybe insecurity as to where they fit into this new model. But I know doctors who feel insecure that they don't know enough about food. Well, you know what? The nutritional therapists and other health professionals know a lot about food. We're very good at diagnosis. We're very good at thinking through complex problems that we have to put together. You know, there is a choice at the moment. Some people, let's go into the private sector, or other people are trying to do this within National Health Service practices. And I don't think the NHS, the way it currently exists, is going to be the NHS that exists in 5 years or even 10 years. It's just simply crumbling. So we need to think of new models. Yes, this works in the private sector. Okay, nothing wrong with that at all. A lot of people want that. But it also can work within the National Health Service. And I must say, I think we have a very underutilized resource in this country, which is the nutritional therapists, who actually, there are very few GP surgeries that have a nutritional therapist with them. And I think what an amazing impact that could have straight away if every GP practice had one to refer to in-house. What Dr. Singh said before about different mental health care services, again, these things are coming. The missing link for me sometimes is integration. So let's say we refer out to a mental health care service about doing some mindfulness. You know, often we do it in a way such that the patient thinks, oh, that is the treatment. So, you know, everything else waits whilst they get that treatment. Come back, I'm not sure that works. Okay, you need a new type of treatment. But there's something in the power of synergy when you do several things together, when you change your diet and you do mindfulness and you start moving. You do them all together. And often I find that that's missing as well. We need to embrace the power of doing all these things together that has a much more powerful effect. Now, our next speaker is someone who is actually straddling both the private sector and the NHS. Don't forget, we do have a panel discussion after our next speaker, right here. We'd love questions. We're getting a few in on Twitter. Please do ask your questions on Twitter via the hashtag Functional Forum, and then we can really engage a debate, not only here live in London, but also with you guys who are watching online. So the next speaker is a GP. She's been working in the NHS for over 12 years. She is a member of the Royal College of General Practitioners. She's also a member of the Institute of Functional Medicine. She's a GP from Manchester, Dr. Sarah Davis.
Today.
Thank you. Good evening. Well, I want to start here. When I was in my first year at med school, I started climbing with a girl who was a bit better than me. I like to think that maybe she was just a bit taller than me and had a bit more reach. But we used to go on trips together, and when we used to buy our food, she would really carefully read the labels of everything, and I thought, oh, she's just got one of these mild food intolerances, you know, the ones we're making really fashionable nowadays. So, but actually, it turns out that she'd spent 12 months wheelchair-bound with ME, chronic fatigue, unable to go to school at 16. She missed out a year of her studies, and this, she found out eventually, was just due to an intolerance to milk. So, fortunately, she did everything herself. She kind of went on the internet, she did all the research she could, and eventually she found her cure. But had she just listened to her medical health providers, perhaps she would have never got better. Perhaps she would have become permanently disabled and become a burden on the state, and she'd have never come climbing with me. But on the other hand, had she come to see one of you, you know, she could have been on the road to recovery within 3-4 weeks, because you know what to look for. And so, really, what was the problem here? It's the standard of care that we have in this country, the systems we have. So her doctors did all the tests and they couldn't find anything wrong. So the presumption is, well, maybe there isn't anything wrong, maybe it's all in her head. So she was given antidepressants, she was given cognitive behavioral therapy and some graded exercise therapy, but all of these things missed the point. And fortunately, she found her own cure. Now, what we need is a new standard of care, one that embraces the new biomedical testing techniques that we have, that embraces diet, lifestyle, nutrition, all the things that in functional medicine we know should be the first line. And I know it's going to be costly to try retraining healthcare staff, to try thinking about how we are going to implement these changes in practice. But there's so many cost savings available if we can help cure people with these very, very simple, cost-effective, very safe techniques, that the impact of that, even if just a fraction of our patients could benefit from these techniques, would just be massive on a societal scale. So what I wanted to talk about was how, hang on, I'm pressing the wrong one. How can we go from where we are now to an integrative pathway, looking at how functional medicine, or the approaches that we use in terms of diet and lifestyle, could become the normal standard of care. And in this country, that really means in the NHS, unless the NHS crumbles around us in the next 5 years. And so looking at ways in which we can use these techniques in the NHS has been something I'm really interested in. And really, we're pushing on an open door at the moment. You know, there is this impetus for change. We've got a new evidence base. So the Cleveland Clinic and other providers are now giving us new evidence for the standard of care that we use in functional medicine. So for our skeptical colleagues who will say, well, this isn't going to work, we're getting more evidence. There's real increase in public awareness as well. So Doctor in the House in the UK has really made a big splash here, and people are really interested. I work in a fairly deprived part of Manchester in the north of England, and I'm constantly amazed that people are really, really interested. They want to avoid the medication, or they want to come off their medication, and they're really willing to change their lifestyle and their diet. Something that if you asked most NHS GPs, do you think your patient could cope with this? They'd say, no, not a chance, not in a million years. But it's happening. And also, just this change in terms of what we're seeing on our supermarket shelves. There's more interesting kind of clean eating. And in terms of all the new recipe books that are coming out, we're really seeing a change in public perception. And finally, the way that we're treating chronic illness at the moment is just unsustainable in terms of cost. As more and more people get type 2 diabetes, we're just going to shell out on more and more drugs. And as everybody lives longer with more and more morbidity, it's just going to cost too much. There has to be a change. And I want to see that change and stay in the NHS, because it could happen in our lifetime. It could happen quite soon. But if we want these changes to happen, there really are some challenges for us. So some of you may not be familiar with the National Health Service General Practice, so I'll just talk a little bit about that. At the moment, General Practice is free. So you can walk in and see a GP whenever you like, but typically you'll get about 10-minute consultation, sometimes less. So a GP will see 30 to 40 patients a day in a good practice, but in places where we've got under-doctoring, we're hearing horror stories about them seeing 50 to 60 patients a day on a routine basis. Because our population is aging, we've got increased polypharmacy, and we've got people with multiple morbidities. So you're trying to take a complex patient and deal with that in 10 minutes. Now, what we do have is the chance for patients to come back repeatedly. But because of the pressure on the budget, what's happening is that the small provider practices are being put into big multi-doctor clinics, and so that every time a patient rebooks, they can see a completely different GP, so no one ever gets to know them. No one ever gets a real holistic feel of what it is that patient needs. And that loss of continuity of care has really been shown to reduce doctor empathy with patients. One of the things that's most sad about the pressures in general practice at the moment is what I'm seeing in terms of GP stress and burnout, which Dr. Singh was talking about. There really is a problem with people leaving the profession. And at the moment, the Health Secretary is talking about importing another 500 GPs from Europe to try and tackle the problem. A doctor who lacks compassion isn't going to be able to adequately assess a patient or make a good diagnosis. And then finally, the last thing that is a challenge for us is that current medical training doesn't really involve anything about diet and lifestyle. And doctors in general are quite skeptical about people that say it's going to make a difference. And I think the problem is that big pharma has really made an impact on the way we do research and the way we're taught to think about illness. So as a doctor, you learn to identify the right pill for every ill. So if you want to learn functional medicine, the only way to do it really is to start off in private practice. So you need to learn. You can try little bits on your NHS patients, and that's quite nice. But if you want to get to grips with the big testing, if you want to learn about genomics and really get to know how it works when you can do a fully holistic prescription for a patient and work with someone over time, in this country, really, you have to go private. It's not really going to help just doing it in the NHS. But once you've learned to do that, you can't switch it off. Once you're a functional medicine practitioner, it's just the way that you think. So if you're going back into the NHS, how are you going to cope with that? I think there are three things that you really need to have to deal with it with confidence. The first is knowledge. So there are all these courses run by IFM, there's loads of podcasts, there's lots of reading, there are many, many books out there. Educate yourself. But the other thing is get some experience too. In private practice, it makes a big difference. Not only are you going to have to explain this to your patients, but you need to be able to explain this to your colleagues. You can't do anything in NHS general practice without somebody looking over your shoulder. And if people start querying what you do, you need to be able to show the evidence and back it up. Anybody that's taking this leap from traditional medicine into functional medicine is going against the flow. You need courage, but don't feel you need to do this on your own. Join the community, get support from them, talk to doctors that have transitioned before you. It makes a really big difference. And just really take heart that you're not just being a weird doctor. There are so many clinicians all around the world that believe in the same medicine that you do. And finally, and this is the problem for our profession as a whole, you need compassion. You need to be able to love that person that's in front of you, treat them as though they were a member of your family. If in your own life you're too stressed, you're trying to get 60 patients out the door, or you've got that massive pile of paperwork that you just need to get through the day so you can start, it's going to be a real challenge to do functional medicine. So sometimes sorting out maybe your own life and your own priorities is what you need to do to be able to practice effective functional medicine. But it doesn't need to be difficult. So one of the things I've found is that you're taking this incredibly intensive, holistic, time-consuming discipline of functional medicine, and you need to put it into a 10-minute consultation. How do you do that? Now, I thought this was going to be impossible, but actually I found it very rewarding and actually easier than I thought it was going to be. The first thing to do is to listen. You can build the timeline in your head, you've got the patient's notes, but really, really acknowledge what it is the patients come to you with, what are their concerns, and tell them you're looking for the cause of their problems. This is a real revelation to most patients. No one's ever tried to figure out why they might feel as they feel before now. And the second thing is the testing. You know, in functional medicine, we don't do anything until we've got a few tests and we know that somebody hasn't missed something obvious. But it's surprising how many patients in the NHS will go on to potentially dangerous medication without even having basic nutritional screening, thyroid screening. And what I tend to do is anybody with psychological, neurological, fatigue syndromes, gastrointestinal problems, they'll all get tested. And that way, I just find so many more pathologies than my colleagues would do. And it's not that they're not there for other doctors, it's just they're not looking for them. And the last thing is making sure that you've got really good access to patient education. So you've only got 10 minutes with this patient, and I often work as a locum, so I may never ever see this patient again. I want them to be able to walk out of the surgery with the tools to educate themselves and to help themselves in the future. So I use websites, typically books. So there's lots of functional medicine practitioners who've written really, really handy books that I can basically prescribe to patients, leaflets and handouts. And I find that that's one of the most effective ways of communicating and allowing patients to educate themselves. So, I sat and had a think about what is it that I do most different from my colleagues now as a functional practitioner when I sit in the NHS office. Cardiovascular disease management. So, yes, I will do the risk analysis and assessment. So, you tell them how likely they are in the next 10 years to develop heart disease. I will discuss with them the advice on statins, and I will even prescribe statins if that's needed. But I'll also discuss CoQ10 and the problems that are potentially arising from statin use. But most importantly, and what gets missed everywhere, is the key issues of lifestyle and dietary management in terms of modifying risk of cardiovascular disease. Now, this conversation with the patient has to be very, very tailored to where they are now. If they are a single mum, living on benefits, still smoking 20 a day, that's a very different conversation than with somebody who is reasonably affluent and is at a point where they're willing to change their diet and maybe do some more exercise. If I'm going to instigate something like the modified Mediterranean diet, I will give them all the tools to be able to do that in a very simple, straightforward way, usually by emailing them a pack with all the information. Digestive disorders, the next thing where I think my practice is quite different. So typically in the NHS, we'd be looking for symptom modification, so something to reduce pain, help constipation, etc. As we know, and as you all know as therapists yourselves, elimination diets make really, really big difference to these patients. It's one of the very simple and straightforward things you can do. It doesn't always work. It depends, of course, what the underlying problem is. But you're going to have a massive success rate just with elimination diet. Now, it is controversial in terms of the NHS, but I think there's enough evidence, which you can then put in the notes, for you to justify adding this advice. The next thing is B12 deficiency. I could talk for a long time about this, but basically I test a lot. I have a very low threshold for testing for B12 deficiency, and I find it very, very frequently because I'm testing in the right places. And then when I see it, I treat it. And I will treat it according to the NICE guidelines, which is use hydroxycobalamin injections 6 and then every 2 to 3 months, depending on the symptoms. But what I see very commonly is GPs seeing very low levels of B12 and just telling their patients to eat better. It doesn't help. It doesn't work. And I think it's just this lack of education and lack of understanding in terms of general practice is that we're not taught about how important B12 is to the biochemistry of the entire body. So there are some education, there is some patient and doctor education to be had here, but if you can look, the guidelines will support you in this treatment. Finally, autoimmune disease. In terms of NHS management, it's very much about trying to manage the patient in primary care for as long as possible, so we don't have to refer on, which is costly, by the way. So every time we have to refer a patient, that's going to cost the GP some money, and we haven't got any money. So we manage them badly for a bit with some symptom control, and that doesn't work. And then eventually we'll refer somebody to a specialist, either a rheumatologist or a dermatologist. But what potential we have here is to actually reverse some of these autoimmune conditions. We know that we can immunomodulate using diet and nutrition. Now, there's definitely evidence for this, but what I would say I tell my patients is, I developed arthritis when I was 14. And it wasn't until I was about 30 that I decided I would do an autoimmune paleo diet myself. And my arthritis has completely vanished and is just due to gluten sensitivity. And that's a very powerful message to share with patients, because if I can get better just from not eating gluten, which is fairly straightforward, then so perhaps could they. So you do have to be sensitive using functional medicine in the NHS. There are problems doing it. I thought I'd offer a few tips. The first thing is, be really confident about your education and be confident about the advice that you offer. So tell your colleagues, I'm a functional medicine practitioner, I've done all these courses, my advice is evidence-based. I don't want them to think that I am just experimenting on their patients. And secondly, there are budget constraints. Don't go doing every test under the sun without speaking to the person who holds the purse strings. So on occasions where I can really see that somebody would benefit from maybe a methylmalonic acid testing, so I see a lady in her 50s maybe who clearly looks like she has B12 deficiency, but she's got normal B12 levels. She's about to disappear off to memory clinic, never to be seen again. But what if she does have B12 deficiency? Now, I can't live with myself knowing that that potentially is the cause. So then I have a conversation with the GP and with the lab saying, could we get methylmalonic acid? And it turns out, yeah, you can. Or you could just try giving them B12. But I will always leave the ball in the court of the senior partner. And there are cases which I just have to leave, where I know I can't do anything else in an NHS setting. If the patient doesn't have any funding, then they can do their best with the advice I can give them, and it stops there. If they do have funds available, then I'll tell them about other functional practitioners in the area, so either nutritional therapist or perhaps a doctor that's local. I have to be very careful not to sell my own services. It's looked on very dimly by the GMC to sell your own services to an NHS patient. Just be aware of that. And I'm also very careful not to undermine the role of the person's own GP, bearing in mind I'm a locum, so I just tend to go into practices and then leave again. I want the patient to know that according to that doctor's own experience and training, they've done exactly the right thing. The fact I offer different advice is because I've been differently trained. The next thing, very, very interestingly, if you go back and read the guidelines, often they fit in with exactly the kind of treatment that we would use in functional medicine. The problem is that at a local level, because of funding constraints and because of misreading of the evidence, things get changed. And what's very useful is to go away and look at the primary sources of evidence and research. And if you're going to do something that looks slightly out of the norm, put that in the patient's notes. It's going to back you up, it's going to support you. And if you want to spend more money on a patient that perhaps wouldn't normally be done, you've got an evidence base for it. So unfortunately, it is more legwork for me as a doctor, but I'm quite careful to protect myself, especially if I'm advising something like taking milk out of a baby's diet. Okay? There are the UK National Milk Allergy Guidelines, which tell you exactly when you can do it, and they're so sensible. They're designed for primary care clinicians to deal and diagnose milk allergy in children and in infants. But so many doctors are not aware of it. And I find even paediatricians will not use them appropriately when I think they would be of benefit. So if you can be aware of those and flag them up in the notes, then no harm can ever come back to you afterwards. Getting to know the local biochemist, again, you can get lots of testing that you wouldn't think you can, and of course they all have their place. So T3, I work in a place sometimes where you can't get a vitamin D level. Somebody decided it wasn't a cost-effective thing to be able to do, so you can't order vitamin D. but normally it is available. T3 is available, you can get oxalate level. So if you see somebody with the urinary problems, interesting to know it's available on the NHS. Learning to talk to the biochemist to explain why you want it, they get really excited because someone is coming to talk to them about biochemistry, a doctor. And they understand why it is that you might want a homocysteine or something like that. And they will often be really helpful. In fact, my local biochemist now, instead of bothering to take methylmalonic acid levels and freeze them and send them down to London, he basically talks the GPs into just giving the patient some B12 and seeing if that works instead. And the final thing is, because you've got this constraint on time, so 10, I often lengthen my consultations a little bit to 15 minutes, make sure you've got easy to access resources in the clinic. It just makes things go a lot more smoothly. So I don't know how this transition from our current model of care to a functional model, hopefully, is going to work out. I don't know if in the future my style of holistic medicine is going to be deemed unacceptable in an NHS setting. But I'm going to continue providing the standard of care that I know to be good and to the best of my ability. And I hope that at some point, hopefully not in the distant future, that will become the same standard that's available to everyone in the NHS.
I think Sarah, as well as being the birthday girl today, gave a fantastic talk, hugely insightful, with quite a lot of new information, I think, for many of us as to what actually is available in our National Health Service when we dig a little bit deeper and spend time to dig a little bit deeper. There are so many things I resonated with in that talk. I'll probably save them for the panel discussion. But the one thing I do want to mention is that it's remarkable how many clinical guidelines, when you actually go and look at them, actually do acknowledge a lot of the sort of therapeutic interventions that we may want to propose. There is that flexibility, but often what happens is common practice and our perceived idea of protocol and what is the norm tends to take over. And so we think this is the norm, and that we think this is what other people think. But when you actually go to the guidance, there is some flexibility there, particularly if it's what the patient wants. And so having that conversation can open that. And you can often put in the notes, you know, patient has requested to try this based upon this. And, you know, the reality is the majority of interventions that we propose in functional medicine, lifestyle medicine, the majority of them are harmless. Okay, and I see nothing wrong. And my responsibility as a doctor is to my patient. And you're right, once you get this information, you cannot go back. You just can't go back. You can't think about problems in the same way anymore. And I don't think doctors are as closed-minded as maybe some of us within the profession have previously thought, or many other professions think. There is a growing awareness, actually, that there is another way. And I find when you actually go and talk to people, yes, there are some closed-minded doctors who think, how can I put it? They're not so complimentary about these kind of approaches. But most doctors who've been actually seeing patients week in, week out for a number of years, do you know what? If you're honest with yourself, you start to get actually, we're not helping that many patients. We're not helping as many patients as we thought we were going to help. And so I admire your passion, Sarah. I really admire your drive and actually you digging beneath the surface and actually finding out that a homocysteine is available in the NHS, or even a methylmalonic acid, which that is news to me, that you can get that on an NHS trust, so that's fantastic. So, look guys, a few questions have been coming in on Twitter. We will take questions in here as well. All the speakers from tonight are gonna come onto the panel, but also we've got Dr. Ayan Panja. He is a GP in St. Albans. He has been trying to sort of navigate the world of integrated medicine for a good 10 years now. I think he's been a practicing doctor for over 15 years, 17 years, that's over 15. And he actually has been practicing a lot of these principles for many years prior to actually doing his formal AFMCP training in the last sort of year or so. And actually, Ayan has actually been working with nutritional therapists in the past. And so, and he currently does. And so, you know, we've added him to the panel. We really appreciate his insights onto the things that he's been doing to apply this within the National Health Service. So without further ado, if I could just welcome the panel to the stage. To start off, are there any questions in here based on anything you want to talk about relevant to tonight, or just general ideas that you may have around this?
One question. As a non-GP who's moving in towards functional medicine and health coaching and doing the AFMCP in March, I'm wondering what is my right to practice and how can I access these tests and provide the complete care that functional medicine promises as a non-GP here in Britain?
Sure. Can you just repeat that on to the microphone? Thank you. What is your training at the moment?
So I'm a UK-trained osteopath.
Okay.
And I'm just starting to move towards the functional medicine paradigm. I'm doing the AFMCP at the end of March, and I'm also just about to start the functional medicine coach academy course as a health coach. So I'm not a GP. I'm wondering, is there any issues with getting insurance or scope of practice for somebody who isn't already a GP who wants to move into this?
Sure. Okay, I think, do you want to start with that, Ian?
That's better, brilliant. I was going to say you're ideally placed, actually, because having a background in osteopathy means that you're already in that model of working holistically. And as we know in osteopathy, I always refer to osteopaths as doctors who actually sort of know how the body works but don't know much about drugs, which is not a bad thing. And many functional practitioners that I know came from that background. And actually, you're better placed, I would say, than most NHS GPs. And you wouldn't have that conflict either of that I have that we've been discussing tonight already, you know, about, can I test for this in the NHS or not? Because it's very explicit that you work outside that system. So go for it. I mean, there's absolutely no problem at all. And in fact, you're probably more intuitively, you'll find that AFMCP fits your model much better than a lot of doctors where, you know, even though I've been in this model of integrated medicine, I think when I went on the AFMCP, I was scratching my head a bit thinking, hang on a second, this is completely the opposite of what we've been doing for years, whereas it won't feel like that for you. So, you know, it's, go for gold, I'd say.
You just need to use the mic, because otherwise all the people at home can't hear.
And with the testing part of it getting access to those tests?
Really straightforward. I mean, that was something that scared me, actually, because I'm used to working with NHS lab tests, and actually you get there and you think, oh my God, these nutritional therapists, they know so much more biochemistry and physiology than I do, in the sense that we don't use that as much on a day-to-day basis in general practice. But actually the tests are very logical, and the companies that provide those lab tests, the support that you get is amazing. I mean, if you go onto the website of any of those companies and actually look at the sample lab reports, you can do a lot of the learning from there. I'm not saying that that's what you should do, but the backup is incredible, completely different to what we're used to in NHS practice. So don't be scared by that. It's very logical, and you're taken through it really well on AFMCP.
I'm just going to take one question from Swiss. We've got Amy Sapola, a pharmacist, who is delighted to hear the focus on interdisciplinary teams as a way of moving forward. And she's a pharmacist, and she's highlighting the role for pharmacists in helping. I just wonder if any of the panel have had any experience of where pharmacists can sort of add value to functional medicine and lifestyle medicine.
I can contribute, because I honestly think in mental health services, pharmacists are a very underused resource. And I mean, the way we use is often, I mean, I mentioned about side effects and medication withdrawal, and the existing evidence is buried again, you know, under heaps of pharma-driven research. So when I work with patients who in whom I cannot differentiate whether this is a relapse of their original illness or a result of a medication which sometimes, you know, they have stopped weeks, if not months ago, I use a pharmacist a lot to correlate that with the evidence. But also, it's very interesting that even after becoming a consultant, I realized that some of the things that you learn on the job might be entirely wrong. So one example is medication taper. Antidepressant medication taper is a very individualized process. And again, I find the input from pharmacists invaluable in discussing how to personalize that to patients to make it safe and tolerable, and also withdrawing. And I mean, you said about a small list of medication that we use. I think my interactions with pharmacists have taught me that you can do a lot of harm with a very small list as well. And actually, the slide that I showed about side effect reporting is something that a pharmacist shared with me. So it was not something that was taught to me during my training or through practice, but it was pointed out that this is where I need to input.
That's fantastic, and really sort of, again, utilizing the skill sets of another healthcare professional. And most GP teams actually have pharmacists either sort of very close or closely, there's close relationships, and I think they can add a lot of value because, you know, to be very clear, functional medicine approaches are not anti-medication, okay? It's about the appropriate use of medication for the right patient rather than the blind sort of over-medication and over-suppressing of symptoms. So there is a role for pharmacists, I think also, but also for deficiencies in certain nutrients that can come about. Sarah, you had something to add?
There, I had a patient recently who I would have loved some pharmacy support for. She was a lady with epilepsy, and she'd been through every anti-epileptic drug known to man. She's ended up on one that was clearly still making her very sick, but because it was controlling her epilepsy, the neurologist wanted to leave her on it. And one of the things I've been doing recently is some of the looking at the genomics, so looking at the detox pathways. So I was able to do that with her and see where she had SNPs that were perhaps uniquely changing her ability to get rid of the toxic byproducts from her anti-epileptic drug. And oh my goodness, it just took me days to try and figure it all out and work out why it was that this lady was getting so sick. But it was possible to do so that I could then give the evidence back to the neurologists and say, actually, you really need to change the dose of this lady's medication. She can't cope with it. It's giving her metabolic acidosis. But a pharmacist would have been an amazing asset in that situation.
Yeah, I just want to add to that, Rangan, is that pharmacists have become really interesting and vital parts of the Functional Forum meetup groups. Yeah. And one of the cool things that I've heard is actually that a pharmacist or a pharmacy is actually quite a good location to have these groups because everyone's using it. There's typically a bit more space than there are in other places, bigger waiting room. So we have maybe a dozen, if not more, meetup groups that are hosted in a pharmacy and have pharmacists there. And typically one pharmacist who gets it will be in a really great resource for potentially a dozen physicians in the community who want to, you know, have a relationship like that there. So if you're starting a meetup group, call the local pharmacists and get them involved because it adds a lot of synergy to everyone else.
Yeah, great. Just one more from Twitter, then I'm going to come to you guys here. I've got an Isabella Natrins watching. She's not in the crowd, is she? No, she is on Twitter. She's definitely tweeted. She is saying that people have forgotten how to cook, so how are we going to make a difference? Okay, and really that got me thinking as to, it's a very, very good point, and that goes beyond the role, or the conventional role, I should say, of a GP practice. And I wonder, does anyone on the panel have a view on that as to whether there should perhaps be a cooking school in every general practice?
Well,
Sarah?
Some time ago, went through the full paleo autoimmune protocol with two small children and a fairly reluctant husband. And the amount of cooking that was required for that to do 4 weeks completely free from everything, I would have really appreciated some support there. Yeah, so if someone could have taken me to a nice class and shown me, but actually as a clinician, having been through that process, and basically living a fairly paleo diet now, I'm actually my own best resource in terms of helping patients, although it's quite time consuming for me and it would be really nice for me to have a health coach to do that instead, but at least I understand what patients are going to have to go through to do that process.
There's lots of published research echoing that physicians, healthcare professionals, are much more likely to recommend treatments or therapies if they have been through them themselves. And I know certainly for me, that's very much been the case. And I try and live and breathe everything that I practice, sorry, that I preach to my patients. And I think that's important. I really do. I think if we're going to talk about the field of lifestyle medicine, I think where possible, we should be, well, not should be, but if we are applying those, I think we're much more likely to not only to tell our patients about them, but to really present it in a way that actually engages them so they actually make a change when they walk out the door. Because it's all right telling them. The other thing I was just going to pick up from Sarah's talk is her her comment regarding, you know, the assumption within certain healthcare professionals, but particularly I see in my profession, that, you know, the patients won't listen. Well, really? It's quite a big assumption to make that our patients won't listen. And, you know, practicing this kind of medicine, it's fun. Patients do listen. Patients want this information. But yes, it's hard in the current system, which is obviously why we're talking about how to integrate it into this current system. James?
Yeah, I was just saying, you know, it's a critical role. And one of the things that we've seen and why we came up with this concept of the functional micropractice, I think if all of us just sort of like take a moment to do a vision board of what the perfect wellness center clinic looks like, it's definitely got a teaching kitchen, right? We'd love to see that. But what we see is also the wreckage of the fact that everyone has this amazing idea and then you have to like start to implement it and then you have to work out the business model and how's it going to be used. And it sounds good until you're the owner, operator, the HR, and all of these different pieces at the same time. And so many in functional medicine 1.0, so many practices failed because they tried to do everything. And they just assumed that if you got a team of practitioners, made them all independent contractors, it would be one big happy wellness family. And the truth is, it doesn't happen like that. The successful practices that look like that at the end typically have a really core service that they get very good at in a low overhead environment, where they work out what is the engine of this practice and it's a team working together. And then once they have a really good client base and they've built to a certain degree, they see, okay, we've got dozens of people on the books that we can communicate to, we know who they are, who are ready to do these cooking classes, and then they make the jump to the slightly higher overhead. And, you know, I think that that's one thing to take into account. You know, that just to go back to your point here, the biggest problem I think that you're likely to have is not like the clinical side, because like Ian said, you have to unlearn the least to do this the most effectively, but it's the non-clinical aspects of running this practice that has caused really the potential for acceleration in the more advanced nations like America in this space have been hampered by the non-clinical aspects of business development. And so I would just encourage everyone that that is a great vision to have these practitioners working together, but there are plenty of cooking facilities that you don't have to own or rent to be able to make this kind of impact. And just to think about that as you're designing your perfect clinic.
Whoa, lots of questions. Okay, yeah, sure, let's go.
Thank you. Well. Yes, my name is Mike Murphy. I qualified as a nutritional therapist in 2015, and last year I exited a 30-year IT career to start my own nutritional therapy clinic. I had a dinner party a few weeks ago, and one of my friends is a senior medical doctor in the NHS on the critical care side, and incredibly dismissive of nutritional medicine. I'm wondering, do you have any advice? Rangan's question is for you. Do you have any advice for nutritional therapists?
Any shows he could watch?
On how to engage as a nutritional therapist with doctors of that mindset.
Okay, so you're talking about someone who may have a closed mindset already, and I think in whatever aspects of life we're talking about, that can be quite a challenging sort of engagement to make. I'll come back to that, but I was going to go back to when I spoke in Edinburgh in November, and I'll explain the relevance in just a second, but I was speaking at the medical school where I was a student, and it was remarkable for me in this packed auditorium that actually some of the doctors who taught me as clinicians were still there in the crowd, and they were still working at the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh. And I felt like a little boy, actually, being on stage in front of people who would teach me medicine not that many years ago. And at the end, there was a Dr. Graham Nimmo, actually, and he is someone who's been teaching advanced life support to all the sort of senior house officers come through. He sort of runs all the cardiac arrest teams. He's been an intensivist. for many, many years. He was a consultant intensivist when I was at medical school, and he's still there. And he came up to me afterwards. He said, I buy into everything you just said. I'm going to send you some stuff about how this sort of medicine is relevant in the intensive care setting as well. And whilst this doesn't directly answer your question, it's just to add that there is hope, actually. There are people out there who are open-minded. There are, you know, I'm guessing that he is probably sort of early, mid-60s, potentially, in terms of he's been practicing for a long period of time. But if you've been practicing for long enough, you start to see where the ceilings are in terms of what we can do. How do you start that conversation? It's very difficult. It is very difficult. I can't really guide you in terms of what you do in that setting, apart from explain your position as professionally as you can. If they're not willing to listen, from my perspective, I think it is quite challenging. Have you got any sort of, anyone can add to that?
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to say that there's a number of issues there, because obviously that person's world is downstream medicine, so he's sort of seeing people who've been scooped up after they've been run over by a bus or whatever, you know, the acute stuff. And I think if you're in that environment for a long enough time, you start to think about people who go gluten-free as being a little bit difficult or crazy, because that's not his world. The other thing, of course, is, you know, if he's like a traditional doctor and he knows that you're a nutritional therapist, he may not even know what a nutritional therapist is. I mean, he's obviously a friend of yours, so I'm hoping he's got some idea. It's hard enough peer-to-peer, doctor-to-doctor, to convince colleagues that work in hospital that there is validity in this model. And I'll tell you the thing that really sells it to these people, it's when they become ill themselves and they sort of realise that the medical model's broken. It works for some people. I find it very hard in the NHS when, you know, someone's been off to the rheumatologist and they feel a lot better on an immunosuppressive drug. It's like, oh yeah, my joints feel great, I'm on methotrexate. And, you know, I have that conflict, the same as these guys, you know, as Sarah, where I think, oh, you know, how much time have I got and how can I pull this back? But actually, I, you know, most of the time I'll say, hang on, well, that's fine, you know, if you feel better, that's great, you know, and I'll see you again in 6 months' time or whatever. So I think it's a case of just constantly chipping away and, you know, if he's interested, he'll find out and he'll learn. But he may never do, and a lot of people don't, and that's fine as well. You know, it's not every battle is worth fighting.
Thank you. Hello. Okay. I don't know if I can add just one small thing to your question, because I. By the way, my name is Raphael. I'm an internal medicine trainee in Edinburgh, Scotland. I'm applying for endocrinology next year. There is a huge percentage of people presenting to A&E with disorders which have no cause. So if you want to convince an acute medical or an A&E practitioner to look into this kind of stuff, say, well, how many of your patients are functional? Chronic abdominal pain, chronic pelvic pain, chronic shortness of breath. These are people who A&E see week after week presenting. You look at their list of admissions, they present 20 times a year. So mention that. Anyway, my question my question is mostly, I think, addressed at Dr. Davis. I was very interested to come to this talk because of the title, NHS. A significant proportion of our patients might not be able to afford a private consultation. So, you know, people come in hospital, classic patient coming with an acute exacerbation of their multiple sclerosis, and you see a 2-liter bottle of Coke on the table and a McDonald's sitting next to it. So for those patients, how do you go from their model of life to a functional medicine? You know, how do you essentially, when you mentioned resources, how do you go there? How do you start the conversation? Where do you point them? Because that is something I struggle with. What resources do I use? Where do I point these people?
Right, well, the first thing is to really start at the beginning and listen to the patient. You need to find out where they are and form a bond with them. No one is going to change their diet and lifestyle unless they have a connection with you. It's a really hard thing to do. And so they have to trust you. So you need to spend time with that person and you need to understand where they are. Maybe that lady with MS has a bottle of Coke on her bedside table because someone's bought it as a gift because she's in hospital. You can't always make assumptions about people. And the other thing is really finding out what it is that specific person needs. It might not be that the thing that they need is a full overhaul of their diet and lifestyle. They may not be somewhere where that's an option. It may just be that actually their mental health needs fixing first, that they need psychological help, and that then when they're feeling better, they would be motivated to perhaps try something else. So never make assumptions about patients. Always find out where they are, and then you can find out what the most appropriate intervention is. And if you listen, you will be able to.
I'd just like to add to that. We had Dr. Terry Walls on the Functional Forum in September, and she's not in practice. She's a researcher practicing inside the VA and in the Veterans Administration. So this is a very limited budget. And so she now is delivering, everyone goes through the functional medicine assessment, but it's working with a functional medicine doctor and RD together. But all of the care is delivered in groups. And she had an amazing quote. We have it as a meme going around online, which is basically that now that I've done this, working in groups, the aha moments, all of that stuff is so powerful that I'll never do it singularly again. So it's the most efficient use of doing it. And I would say the person that teaches them to stop drinking Coke and maybe the McDonald's might not be the doctor, but if you set up a system where there's another patient who's getting better with MS who says, oh, you got to get rid of that stuff. The first thing I did was get rid of that stuff and I felt better. Oh, what, you had MS and now it's improving because of that? That is really powerful. And we're in such a good position to put those people together. They literally categorize by disease, and if not disease, then disease, you know, categorized by the underlying pathology. You know, in America, we see group visits where they're doing not group visits based on, you know, the histology of the disease, but actually the root cause. So if you've identified that there's gut permeability in this lupus patient, this MS patient, and this rheumatoid arthritis patient, they can be really powerful in a group together because essentially the same insults are just causing a break in the chain depending on the genetic vulnerability of the different people. And so I would highly encourage, as you start to think about how this can be rolled out, I mean, to me, it seems likely the functional medicine operating system will be rolled out in the NHS in a group format. It just seems the most likely to me because groups visits always starts as a resource constraint. And then when people actually do it, they're like, actually, there's some magic here that is not possible in a one-on-one intervention. So if I could encourage again, if I was giving the year of 2017, what if we all just like innovated in group visits, just tried it and learned from each other? That's the point of these communities, is to learn from each other. And I really think that, to answer your question, it solves the resource constraint. It's not expensive for people. And the majority of the value comes from the peer-to-peer interactions, which is, you know, exactly what's happening in mental health. It's a really exciting time.
Can I just add that don't stop having the conversations because you have an intuition that it wouldn't go anywhere. But at the same time, I think be respectful of where the patient is and what they're ready to receive. So, I mean, I've sometimes come across patients who tell me that after about 10 years, you are the second person who's mentioning this. And they remember because, you know, this is something very different to what they're expecting to hear. So you have no idea when the penny would drop and when they might. And I really liked Sarah's point about resources, because I think anybody on this journey, you would end up, your Macs are probably filled to capacity with stuff that you have signed up and collected. And yeah, just, you know, slip the Walls protocol when she's not looking.
I absolutely agree. You never know when the pen's going to drop something. You just never know. And it could be that you just drop it in there in that console, in that moment. I mean, for 5 years, nothing will happen. And then you may not even know the impact that has 5 years later when someone else mentions it. Think, actually, you know what? I may try that. And we've seen that. And it's just, you know, do your best and do what you're doing. I was going to answer your point about the your colleague or your friend who is a bit skeptical. You know, like the paper which Dr. Singh put up about nutritional medicine as mainstream in psychiatry, which I think came out about March 2015 in The Lancet. And I remember clearly when it came out, because that for me was one of those markup papers and keep it in your bank for when you need to have those sort of conversations, because suddenly The Lancet you know, this kind of prestigious medical journal talking about nutritional medicine as mainstream, suddenly that gives it a bit more weight. Should it give it more weight? No. Does it? Yes. So it's those kind of things that I think are worth keeping up your sleeve for those sort of conversations. But we've got time for one more question. I think you've had it up. Oh, sorry, we'll try and continue the conversation afterwards.
Thanks very much. My name's Nicole Freres. I'm a GP working in Islington, and I've been burrowing away as an autodidact in functional medicine and nutrition, and sort of broke through the fear barrier a couple of years ago. Blast this, I'm just going to practice. So I started to, and it's been an amazing journey. And it's such a thrill to be here and feel that it's beginning to take off. And I would say that I think the NHS is, it's a different model, but it's a perfect model for functional medicine. And particularly in the context of general practice, you speak about communities and, you know, in a society whose fabric has been pretty kind of ripped apart, general practices still are their communities. You know, that's where people meet. I feel that we need to identify the nodes where we can really focus and put all the evidence-based developments of functional medicine. For example, I did a talk to GP trainers, and that then has a ripple effect throughout, because then that maybe a few of them will then begin to clock it. So I think and trainers meet twice, you know, a couple of times a year. They're also setting up sort of patient support groups. So, you know, getting all the diabetic patients or rheumatoid patients and just giving them the basics. I mean, I think the biggest impact really has been just getting people off wheat and grains and, you know, just giving some basic nutrition advice. And that can be done quite easily in groups. So I was just wondering about, you know, thinking about the system, the NHS as a system, and just identifying those nodes in terms of the places where it'd be most efficient for us to really put our energies and share the information.
Thank you very much for that. I guess that we've really got time for just one of you to answer that about, you know, what are those nodes within the NHS which we can get a quick win on. I think is my summary of that.
I think in my experience, you know, I see possibilities everywhere. I mean, there is not a single setting where I feel I cannot slot this in. And again, it has to be judged. But again, so for example, from where I practice, there is again, you know, we have constantly have medical students coming in, trainees coming in. There are opportunities for teaching and training. And I think in a team like mine, I have got a lot of liaison with GPs. So last week I spent half a day at a GP surgery. And it's so interesting that what we were talking about, because I was describing one of their patients who was basically living on 36 cups of tea and coffee, having one meal, and that he has been doing that for about 17 years. And there was one GP that all the other GPs were pointing. He said, he does that. So again, I mean, that particular GP is probably not going to be on board. But again, using those interactions to kind of test the waters about where readiness is. But I mean, just like I said earlier, it's about having these conversations again and again, because people have literally come out of woodwork to connect within my own team, within the larger organization, as well as people outside. And can also mention about patient experts. I mean, in any policy work or strategic meetings, there are patient representatives, and you know, they just naturally connect to this message, and they have huge influence where change is required, and I think they can be recruited in spreading the message as well.
Thank you. And I thought it was a great story that you finally built up the courage to start practicing this way. And I think there is a huge load of healthcare professionals out there who feel the same way and are just lacking that courage. And I think it's meetups like this that are actually helping engage this movement. The next functional forum, the next international functional forum is coming up in April. on April the 4th, and we actually have the Institute of Functional Medicine here in London for the preceding 5 days at the AFMCP, the Applying Functional Medicine in Clinical Practice course. So we're going to have probably some members of the Institute of Functional Medicine faculty here for that functional forum. We're going to try and get a bigger venue. This one's sold out. There's a lot of demand for it. And I think you can all see why it really is. We're on the verge of something special here, I think, on this side of the Atlantic. So please do sign up for that. If you don't have a meetup, if you enjoyed it tonight, please do consider getting a meetup in your area. It's a great way to foster a local community. And thank you very much to the panel. Thank you very much to all the speakers. That's it from here, the Royal Society of Medicine in London, and we'll see you on April the 4th. Thank you.